had a very good hearing, a lot of good witnesses. We had people from all over the country come in and talk about their experiences and what they had done. The hearing went about 11 hours, which is a little long for most hearings, but not so much for education. And we have a lot of folks who are very emotionally involved in education, and they enjoy talking about it. And we had quite a few witnesses after our invited testimony. But
Summit, I know Texas, the state legislature meets every other year, just on odd-numbered years. So when
yes,
you
sir.
Hear that this happened on an even-numbered year, like 2016, the point is this is not about a particular bill, right? It's not that Texas has identified a certain idea. It's let's just have a hearing on the various different forms of school choice.
Right. We have, as you said, every other year we meet from January to the end of May, with the exception we sometimes have special sessions. But in the interim, between sessions, we have interim charges where we look into things, getting prepared for the next session, or even looking back on bills that we pass to see how well they're going, and how, you know, a lot of times there's rules and regulations that have to be put together. So we look to see how well the agency has done with those. So it's pretty routine. We've been very busy this interim, though. We've had probably four or five interim hearings in education.
So handicap the politics, if you would, for us. For some, they're confused by Texas, looking at the politics of the state, thinking this would be a place where there'd be maybe the most school choice in the country, because you would associate maybe some Republican politics with the idea that private school choice encourages markets and competition, and that tends to be more of a Republican idea. And yet, Texas defies that with, you know, no private school choice programs, unlike other maybe purple states that like Wisconsin or Louisiana that have statewide vouchers.
Or even really blue places like Washington, D.C. I mean, we are an outlier. In fact, I saw a map yesterday showing all the different states that have some form of school choice, well over half, and we're surrounded by states that have school choice. And we are one of the few outliers really in the whole country that does not have some form of school choice.
Now, that said, of course, you do have charter schools and you have magnet schools and you have choice in those regards, which many, you know, in my world would consider that school choice, too. But you're talking about private school choice.
Exactly. And we do have, you know, a lot of that type going on. The charters have a big demand for charter schools. We have a lot of magnets coming on. We have intra-district movements allowing students to move around in some areas. But we don't have the option for people to really get private, particularly special needs students and those types of things. So that's what we're working on.
So let's make some news here. What do you predict is going to happen? Do you think finally now there is sentiment in the legislature to move this needle?
Well, we did pass a bill last session with tax credit scholarships in the Senate. Unfortunately, we did not get a hearing in the House. And so I understand they're going to have an interim hearing here in the House here on October the 17th, I believe, to talk about school choice in the House. But yeah, that has been, of course, that was the first time the Senate had passed a bill either. So we made progress in that regards. But I'm working really during the interim trying to find out what we can get through the House, work with some of our House members and colleagues. One, trying to, you know, show them the facts and the reasoning behind why we need this. I think it's going to be a little overwhelming for someone when they see the map that I saw yesterday showing all of our neighboring states and, frankly, states all over the country that already have some school choice. And we're behind the eight ball, way behind the rest of the country on this. And we normally are used to being a leader, particularly on conservative issues like this.
But are you optimistic? Handicap this, like, where is the legislature maybe more sympathetic this next session? Do you expect it to be in 2017 than they were in 2015?
Well, I think we're refining our tactics. And my personal opinion is we need to put it together with something else that people like, and wrap it all in one big package where everyone gets a benefit. And I think we'll have a better opportunity of passing something along those lines rather than just going a single shot all by itself.
Oh, wrapping it together with what, for example? What would be just...
Well, we have a number of issues that we're working on. There's always a lot of reforms we're working on in education. We've done a lot already. We have more to go. But, you know, just finding something that people need to have. You know, we have a very complicated school finance formula, for example. We may be able to put something together with that. That's really what we're kind of working on right now, is trying to figure out what is that. Well, first of all, you know, I'll be visiting with House members, you know, what kind of school choice could they live with? And then figuring out how we can wrap it up with something else to even get more votes on board because of something else we paired it up with. So it's about a lot of tactics and strategy, and I couldn't tell you that we have it all worked out right now, but I'm working on several different avenues.
Okay. So would it be I mean, so I'm not sure if you would it be correct to say you're optimistic, or you think it's sort of a work in progress, and you have no cause for optimism.
I think we have a chance. I think we're further along than we were last session. But like I said, we have passed one. People in the Senate are used to voting for one. So now we have some flexibility to figure out what the House will accept. And I think we can get the Senate on board with that. So we'll be working with our colleagues on that. And then, like I said, they'll be having an interim hearing here just a little bit so we can see what comes out of that hearing and get a better idea what they're looking at.
And finally, Larry Taylor, what form of school choice?
Can I add one more thing?
Sure.
Yeah, we're going to have a new education committee chair in the House as well. So we have some opportunity for just some different players that we didn't have maybe before. And, you know, possibly the governor getting involved. So we have some other things working as well.
There's an opponent to private school choice in Texas named Charles Butt. He is the owner of a large supermarket chain in Texas and is said to be a billionaire and thrown some money behind, well, opposing private school choice. Will he be a factor?
He is. He has a group called Raise Your Hand Texas that he helps fund. I think he's probably the majority funder of that. And they do work it. And I've actually had him here in this office and had a long discussion with him about this very issue. And, you know, if you look at the HEB stores, they are really very nice stores. They've got all kind of features and things that you didn't used to have in grocery stores. And I asked him, you know, why did you do that? Well, of course, it was competition. But he doesn't seem to make the connection between what he's done in business and what we could be doing in education. I mean, our educational system could be so much better with competition. We know competition drives innovation, it drives improvements in quality, improvements in productivity. All those things come out of about real serious competition, and he's in it. He's doing very well in that competitive environment in the grocery store business, but he doesn't seem to make the transition how that could also work in education for all of our students.
So you think he'll be just as obstructionist this cycle as he was the last cycle?
Well, I just heard hearsay that there may be some change there, but I don't believe that. I'll believe it when I see it.
And finally, Texas State Senator Larry Taylor, what form of school choice would you like to see most? There's education savings accounts have been discussed in Texas at your hearing last week, and they already exist in Arizona, and they have been passed in other places. Certainly statewide vouchers have been popular in places like Indiana. There are tax credit scholarship plans that have been very popular in places like Florida. What do you like?
Well, I like what I get passed. You know, whether it's tax credit scholarships, ESAs, or straight up parental choice universal, we need to get something over the wall. And I think once we do that and people start seeing the benefits of that, I think it'll grow from there. But we've got to get something on the other side of the wall. And right now we just keep running up against the wall. So I like whatever we can get passed.